So today we are going to understand inelastic scattering and its applications in chemistry, also the beam damage in electron microscopy and the applications of beam damage in chemical sciences and other sciences. So I think you are aware of inelastic scattering's applications in chemical sciences because we have covered these topics earlier also. All these techniques you are aware of, I think you are aware of. So the foremost technique of inelastic scattering is nothing but X-rays actually. X-rays are the pioneer, I mean the flag bearer of inelastic scattering. So those have been so useful that, and another technique is EELS, electron energy loss spectroscopy. So these two techniques are so popular, and Auger and other things. And beam damage is so popular it is one of the most enriching applications of electron microscopy to the humans, because due to beam damage, one application, electron lithography, has come out. And due to electron lithography, you have all your devices, actually, all your silicon chips are all, the contribution comes from electron lithography. Okay, so let us understand this. Any questions so far? Okay. So keep your communication open. So we start with inelastic scattering by knowing a little bit about Röntgen, because when we discuss so much of science, we forget sometimes the contribution from the giants. So one of the person, great person, is Wilhelm Röntgen. He was a German physicist, and he died around 1923, right? Okay, and he was the person who first produced and detected electromagnetic radiation. We call it, right, X-rays, or nobody knows this name as Röntgen rays. But so he was the first person who got the Nobel Prize in physics, because it started in 1901. And the first prize was given to. So let us. I thought to share some of his life experiences, because today we all are driven by mad rush of taking credits, patents and protecting patents, taking credits and beating our own drum or Twitter. We have published this article, that article. There, it's all encouraged. It's fine, but. If you see the story of this great man, so I think all of you are aware that before X-ray crystallography, X-ray imaging in medical sciences came much earlier than the X-ray crystallography. So after Röntgen discovery, its application came immediately in the medical imaging, because this was the first medical image, you can say that, which saw the see-through image of the hand of his wife with a ring. Actually, it's a very famous picture, hand with rings, actually. So it was taken on 22nd of December 1895. And another thing is that he died out of cancer, of intestinal cancer. People think that it was not due to his work with X-rays, because he used to wear lead shield. Being a physicist, I think he was aware of what the damage these waves can do. So in his will, he left the will that all his scientific correspondent, all his personal letters should be destroyed upon his death. People want to protect his memory. He wanted to destroy his memory. So he was, and he donated all the money he got from Nobel Prize to his university, you know that Nobel Prize, how much money is associated with that. Even in those times, it was one of the most rewarding award, monetary rewarding. Like Pierre Curie, Röntgen refused to take out patents. And now you look at the world today, it is like a mad rush for patent. It's basically is like a badge of honor, actually, how many patents you have. So he refused, actually. Because of his refusal, this technique has benefited so many, you know, billions and billions of people in last 120 years of this, its discovery, actually, more than 120 years. You know, you can see that first image was probably 120 years exact. So he refused, and also people wanted to name X-rays after him, and he refused, actually. He refused that this rays should not be named after him, actually. So I thought that it's like my gratitude to this great physicist. So not because we are living in a time where everybody is running after credits. And here is a man, great man, who did not want any credit, right? So I think we should look at the opposite examples as well. And So the second thing is the contribution from, now you can see the Braggs, we know that, you know, another British scientist, actually, right? This is, Röntgen was German person, German scientist. And now you see the father and son, you know, Braggs. Now we know Braggs diffraction, you know, Braggs, so they were probably, you know, grateful that it was reflection, Bragg's reflection or Bragg's diffraction actually should be named after them. I mean, they probably did not have any problem. So you can see the title of the paper is not diffraction, but reflection, actually. Now we know that because that time they thought that it is just waves, actually waves are reflecting. And in this paper, if you notice that Braggs have mentioned about Lavey, seeing the Lavey's photograph, you know that Lavey also got Nobel Prize, I think a year or two earlier than Braggs, actually. So the contribution was that they solved the crystal structure, while Lavey proved that X-rays can diffract. So inelastic scattering, what is inelastic scattering? Inelastic scattering simply means that when electrons travel through your sample, they come out with energy which is not the same as the energy which they were carrying originally. So there is a difference in the energy. There is usually a loss of energy while traveling through the sample. And this loss of the energy is because of the nature of the sample. And this loss of energy can happen because of several interesting processes which takes place inside the sample. There are many, many processes, basically, I have not taught you, and I don't intend to taught all the processes because they may not be of interest to the chemistry students. But they are generally highly important, actually. There are so many ways. So inelastic scattering does not happen at mostly at the forward scatter. I mean, it happens at higher angle. But just imagine if elastic scattering inelastically scattered electrons ends up forward scattered, because in forward direction we are capturing electrons for bright field, dark field, and selected area electron diffraction as well as HRTM. So they might have interfered with those signals, actually, but so this diagram you have seen many times. It is taken from a William Carter book. Wherever you don't find reference cited, please note that it has come from Barry Carter's book, right? I've been telling it all the time. So So normally I cite the reference, but there are so many, you know, thousands of slides in this lecture series that it is impossible to, because it's a teaching course. So it is not possible to cite so many references on each slide. Okay, so I just tell to the audience, you know, it's my disclaimer that it is mostly based, my lecture series is based primarily on the William Carter book. Okay, so having said that, so we know that why does inelastic scattering happen at high angle? I mean, what is the reason that electrons lose energy? There are several ways electrons can lose energies. I told you only a few of them, but there are ways. I mean, for example, I'll come to that actually. I'll explain when the slide comes. So probability of transfer of energy goes up when electron penetrates deeper inside the atom. I have been telling this. So the deeper the electron penetrates inside the atom, the greater the energy that may be lost. And it is possible, but very rare, that electron will lose entire energy in a single nuclear interaction. Just imagine that, how much energy one single electron carries, 200 kilo electron volt or 300 kilo electron volt. That's a massive amount of energy. So, and then that's why we discuss about beam damage done by the beam. Okay. So this range of inelastic scattering produces a range of scattering angle, but there is no simple relation. So now basically, what are the signals generated during the inelastic process? So there are like X-rays. X-rays, basically, you have individual atomic interactions, which come from your core electrons being kicked out, and then X-rays being emitted. And then you have secondary electrons, which you have discussed in the scanning electron microscopy images. Last thing is very important, last point. There are more complex processes which results from collective interaction, which I have not taught you. They are actually plasmonic and phononic interactions. So in order to teach those plasmonic phononic interactions, I need to teach you what is plasmon and phonon. Like, so that is all good for physicists. So if you are interested, I can teach you separately. For chemistry audience, I don't teach them. But if you are intending to do yields, deeper analysis of electron energy loss spectroscopy, you can't escape physics. So any of these techniques, if you want to go in detail, you have to have deeper understanding actually. How do I compare the probability of inelastic scattering with the elastic one? Why is it important in real life? Real life, it is important that I know how much signal I'm getting. I give you some number, if you remember, in scattering processes before the elastic scattering class. I told you that scattering, when we were discussing about first time about the scattering cross-section, I think I mentioned that scattering cross-section inelastic scattering cross section is four order magnitude less, and it's around 10 to the power minus 24 meters square. And for elastic scattering cross section is I think 10 to the power minus 20 meters square, something like that. Or it is like, it was I think 10 to the power minus 22. That makes the radius as 0.1 angstrom, and it was I think elastic one was 10 to the power minus 26. So that makes the radius as 0.1 picometer, right? 10 to the power minus 13 is exactly 0.1 picometer, right? So this is very important actually to understand. And yes, you can see that. I mean, generally, So that was a general number, but here we have more specific number. So basically, different inelastic processes have different scattering cross section. So if you see it here, just a moment, let me plug in the. So if you see, this is P stands for plasmonic response. Okay, this is highest actually. So you can see that this contribution in terms of its probability. This represents actual probability, right? It's a scattering cross section in meters square. Okay, it is a logarithmic scale, and this is actually going down this way, so it is going up this way, right? So you can see this is plasmonic. So this is the plasmonic actually is a collective oscillations, right? Because of collective oscillation of electron cloud, and E stands for elastic processes. So maximum energy loss actually happens into the the plasmonic emission. Actually, those are photons. Actually, plasmonic emission is basically when you say plasmonic emission. Okay, the So after the plasmonic emission, you get actually electromagnetic radiation, mostly in the visible range. Okay, so after that comes the elastic process. That means you know that bright field, dark field, HRT, electron diffraction, they're all Hadoop and backscattered electron, they're all made of this domain, right? So they all bunch up here. So after that, you have X-rays. So X-rays frequency probability is much smaller, order of magnitude smaller. And you can see that K is even much smaller than K is K probability of K. Emission of K X-rays like K alpha 1, K alpha 2, K beta 1, K beta 2, whatever, is smaller than L. Okay, and last, probability of emission of secondary electrons, which actually comes from your valence band or conduction band, so that is much smaller. You can see that the number is much smaller. And on X scale, you can find the energy of incoming electron beam, right? What about the angular distribution? You remember that we just finished the previous lecture by giving you this beautiful equation, and we could plot the scattering cross section for elastic processes, and then we had the for the single atom. All these plots are for single atom, and then when we plug in the structure factor, then we have this structure associated with that. So this is for collection of atoms, right? But do we have something similar? No, answer is that it's very disappointing that inelastic processes are highly complex and they are poorly understood. So there is no, the physics is not, we don't have actually equations. Sadly, but okay, don't cry. No, it's fine. So is there any use of energy loss processes, or they just change your precious sample? So energy loss processes are really great. I've been telling you that in chemistry, it's really highly important. So they are also damaging. You can say that energy, so now energy loss electrons causes Kikuchi lines to appear, and Kikuchi lines are extraordinarily useful. You know, this word is, it carries weightage actually, right? And yields have got, but they can be nuisance because these energy loss electrons can, basically they are making electrons, primary electrons, less monochromatic. For example, you can have simultaneously the presence of 200 kilo electron volt, and you can have simultaneously 200 kilo electron volt minus delta E. Delta E is the energy which is lost into these processes. For example, Eales processes, but these electrons are simultaneously reaching and contributing to your bright field, dark field, unless you energy filter them, right? You can energy filter them, but they are not, normally it is not done inside a cheap microscope, which we have, and it is very expensive to put energy filter. So they form a background in diffraction pattern. DP is basically diffraction pattern. But you can filter them off. So they can be, so these energy loss processes are both useful, and they can be nuisance actually because they basically deteriorate the quality of your elastic images, actually elastic scattering processes. So now X-ray emission, if we start one by one, X-ray emission, I think you know that X-ray emissions are two kind. One comes from your elemental, basically they are the result of your core electron being kicked out, and then the electron from higher orbit jumping to take the place of the vacancy, and then in this process you have the X-rays which are which carries the information about the element they belong, and there is the Bremsstrong X-rays which are useful to the biologist, and but they are considered nuisance by material scientists.
Sir, last slide.
This one?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So, why Bremsstrong X-ray is a nuisance for material scientists?
Bremsstrong X-ray is basically, again, let me show you how it looks like. I don't have picture, but I can just draw it. Don't worry. I can draw it here. Same problem that Bremsstrong actually is forms a background actually, and on this background these characteristic X-rays form like sharp peaks. Okay, for example K alpha. Now if you are only looking for example, so this is your real sample there, this is your real signal when you get. See, please note that life is not that simple. So, for example, what I'm trying to tell you that you have, this is your sample, and this is your detector. For example, EDS detector, energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, EDS detector, right? Which you are using to understand some. You are using EDS detector to do some chemical analysis, that what is the percentage, atomic percentage of particular atoms from periodic table in my sample here. So now what you are going to do, so this sample is emitting X-rays, right? X-rays are being emitted by this sample and they are reaching here. And you are, they are creating some signal. I'll tell you, I mean, they are actually creating electron hole pair. Let's not go into the physics. So they are actually creating some signal here. And that signal is proportional to the energy. And then we can find out the energy of these. Now, problem is that you are getting, this signal is also reaching there and these peaks are also reaching there, right? So this electron hole pair will be also generated by your background signal. So how do you know that it is coming from, how much is coming from your K alpha or K beta? Because please note that intensity of these, respective intensities of these, as well as the energy and the intensity will be responsible for deciding your chemical composition of your sample. Now you understand that it's a big nuisance, right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir. So then how it is useful for biologist?
Who is this guy? Hemant?
Yes, Hemant.
Ah, Hemant. Yaar, I am also one third of a biologist actually. So I try to answer, I ask many biologists, and I try to search for, I'm searching answer of this question since last more than 10 years, I did not get. But this is written in the book, W.C. William N. Carter have written, and I did not find how it is useful to the biologist, but it is written there. If you find answer, please let me know. Sometimes students have better answer, they are smarter to find needle in the haystack. So if you find the answer, I'm not joking at you, I'm serious about that. Sometimes students can help the teacher to find the answer which the scientist is not, teacher is not able to find the answer. Okay, so please, Hemant, I request all of you to please help me. I mean, I did not find, I have been searching since last 10 years. I talk to many people also. So It's a statement. I'm verbatim. I'm quoting from the, you know, this source. This source is quoted here, in the famous book, and yeah. So I, for the sake of completeness, I don't delete this sentence, even though I have no example to share, but I'm interested, so I keep this sentence as it is in my slide, so that to provoke some thoughts, not to impede some thought. I mean, I don't know, that does not mean that that sentence has to be deleted, right? You understand what I mean?
Yes, sir.
So the sentence is a reminder that I do not know. Yeah. So.
Sir, one more, sir.
Yes, yes, sir. Bolia. Yes, yes, yes.
Sir, this is just for curiosity, sir.
Oh, the science is all about curiosity, man.
Sir, actually, you said electron loss its energy in atom. Yeah, if it will go in deeper.
Yes.
Sometimes completely. Sir, what happened if electron loss its energy in the atom, sir? Sir, because there are one more electrons, and we don't know where it is. For example, it is in between nucleus and K cell, sir. It lost its energy, sir. What happens then?
So, see, electron, by the virtues of Pauli exclusion principle, has no place to stay in the atom. It can't stay there, right? So it has to come out of the atom, right? It can't stay there. You understand?
Yes, sir.
It will transfer its energy, but and in this process, it will just it will become a nuisance charge. It will charge up your sample. It will just sit on the your sample, but it will be taken care of by your TEM grid, the copper TEM grid, carbon coated TEM grid, which is conducting. So it will be just grounded, actually. Got it?
Sir, actually, if electron lost its energy in between nucleus and the K cell.
What do you mean by between nucleus and K cell? What do you mean by that? Scientifically, what do you mean by that?
Yeah, actually,
what is there? There is nothing. There is empty space.
Yes, sir. That's
see, electron can lose energy by interaction. See, for example, you are running in high speed, so you are losing the energy through the friction from the road. You are losing the energy from the aerodynamics. You know, the friction from the wind. Or you bump into another a pedestrian on the road, and then you may transfer some energy to some person on the road, and then he will shout on you, okay? you bang on the
it means it will repel from the atom.
Oh yes, electrons do not have any place, any vacancy. If they have place, then only they can stay. There is no place. Please note that electrons, you know, the atomic structure is very, the energy levels are so to visit. You know, there's no place, actually. There's no vacancy, unless there is a vacancy, right? Yeah, you are a chemist, so you know that it's not, you know, unless you deionize the atom. Then you can,
No, sir. I'm not a chemist, sir. I'm a chemical engineer, sir.
But you are a scientist, right?
Yeah.
So you are a scientist. So, so basically, what I'm trying to tell you that you ionize the atom, then there is a vacancy, and then you can reduce the atom. You can give some electron, and it will happily take, for example, sodium, potassium. They will be happy to convert to zero state. You need to have some deficiency of electron. You need to ionize the atom. If you kick out some electrons from some of the energy levels, then that atom will be happy. It will bless you. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good question.
Answer, please teach sir plasmonic emission and all, sir.
Sorry?
Sir, plasmonic emission and all, sir.
You want to study?
Yes, sir.
Don't take panga, yaar.
Yes, sir. I would like to also, sir.
Kaun bol raha hai? Itni himmat?
Sir, Mayur, sir.
Mayur, I will teach separately. I will not teach a part of this course because I have to finish the, okay? because there are a lot of chemistry students. So you can send a separate request to me. I have the slides which are hidden, so I can teach separately. But yeah, so you can send email requests to me, whoever wish to study. But looking at the marks, I'm not very excited. I'm not in excited state.
You said you are not thinking about the marks.
अच्छा जी अच्छा जी बहुत बढ़िया आपको मार्क्स तो चलेंगे यू नीड मार्क्स टू पास द एग्जाम आई डोंट नीड आई मार्क्स आई डोंट नीड मार्क्स बट समबडी एल्स नीड मार्क्स ईसीएस है
सर आई हैव वन क्वेश्चन सर
यस सर बोलिए
सर जब एक्सरे हमारे पास में आती है तो हम लोग उसमें से कैसे
हमारे पास नहीं आती है हां
नहीं नहीं मतलब
यस
सर सर हाउ वी कैन डिस्टिंग्विश बिटवीन वेदर द एक्सरेस आर कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स और द कंटीन्यूअस एक्सरेस
बाय लुकिंग द एनर्जी एनालिसिस बाय स्पेक्ट्रोमीटर यू जस्ट पास इट टू द स्पेक्ट्रोमीटर यू नो दैट इफ इट इज द एनर्जी इज बेसिकली यू कैन डू द एनर्जी एनालिसिस एनर्जी डिस्पर्सिव सो यू नो दैट इट इज if it is like you know if the energy profile so your spectrometer will tell you right for example white light you send it to spectrophotometer and it splits into different you know wavelengths right got it did you get the answer
yes sir
so that's what this EDX detector does EDX detector exactly does the same what you are telling right it basically separates out what I'm telling you that but this peak has its background from Bremsstrom right
yes sir
so there is a continuation to this peak and all those peaks from Bremsstrom so that's
is there problem. Any kind of filters sir
how will you do that
any yeah, kind of filter is there
of,
sir
think of there is the how can you filter from signal I mean x-rays don't have you know x-ray photon has only two identities right its energy and its direction theta in which it is coming right those are the two identities n number of x-ray photons right that we call as intensity or amplitude whatever you call it right and if you are looking at the phase and then that's a different thing because in Bragg diffraction you are looking at the phase also let's not go into that coherency and other things but primarily it is all energy so electron does not have a tag that it is coming from you know those atomic emissions are in the core level or it is coming from Bremsstrom process which is continuous emission right it does not has its tag it does not has any you understand what I mean
yes sir
yeah so it's just x-ray photon it does not have any identity where it is coming from so we are interested as scientists we are interested actually where it is coming from that's why that information we can get only from its energy analysis we can just guess that it might be coming from K-shell or something like that right that's the only way when we do the energy dispersive analysis right when we disperse yes, that right see for example light you know light in your room we don't know we can't say that it is coming from your tube light or from sunlight if suppose both the sources are lighting your room unless we know that how the sun's solar spectrum looks like and how the tube light spectrum looks like but photon does not have any identity that it has originated from this source or that source you understand photon is photon it has just the identity
yes,
that it has some energy okay
yes sir.
Any other question
no but sir
nice questions only two people are asking questions anybody else Anybody else, please?
Sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Sir, Bremsstrahlung means generation or X-ray generation. Sir, X-ray is also used for CT scan. So, sir, can, मतलब sir, उसको relate नहीं कर सकते क्या बायोलॉजी से? मींस
यस यू आर राइट एक्चुअली, आई मीन यू आर राइट दैट एक्चुअली प्रियांशी यू नो व्हाट इज द मीनिंग साइंटिफिक मीनिंग?
यस सर, यस सर,
लेट मी एक्सप्लेन यू व्हाट इज द साइंटिफिक मीनिंग ऑफ प्रियांशी. यू वांट टू नो? I've been thinking about the difference between Supriya and Priyanshi that day during that lecture. You know what is it? What is the scientific meaning? Priyanshi is basically a distillation
of. The meaning of Priyanshi is lovable, dear.
No, Priya. No. Priya and Ansh basically the extract of Priya. Extract. So it's basically, yes, you put several priyas into the rotary evaporator, and you basically it's a distilled, double distilled priya in chemistry language. Okay. Properties, good properties of yes. priyas. You do the distillation. Okay, and that's called priyas. Okay, Ansh, you know, the extract of priya.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So Priyanshi has actually contributed very nicely. See, basically, when you do the imaging, can you mute yourself, Priyanshi? Yeah. Or
yes, sir.
Mute yourself.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Priyanshi, there is a facility in Zoom that you can filter the background noise. Okay, let us not. So the background noise, Priyanshi, is like brimstrong radiation, and your voice is like, you know, characteristic X-rays. How will you handle in the Zoom room? So background noise is like brimstrong. Okay, and your voice is basically X-rays. Okay, so how do you filter that? There is a facility in Zoom that you can filter it off. You have to look at the settings, but there is a large amount of background signal in your voice. So Priyanshi has actually told very, very nicely, very intelligent answer, actually very intelligent answer. I am thankful. She is telling that in CT, it does not, brimstrongs are fine. I mean, you don't need characteristic X-rays for, you're right, Priyanshi, I agree with you. You're right. I did not think that way. Thank you very much. मैंने उस तरीके सोचा नहीं, बट व्हाट शी इज टेलिंग दैट यू डोंट नीड एक्चुअली अ शार्प एक्सरे लाइंस, यू नीड देम फॉर एक्स यू नो मटेरियल कैरेक्टराइजेशन फॉर बट फॉर बायोलॉजी यू डोंट नीड एक्चुअली, आई मीन फॉर मेडिकल इमेजिंग. एंड आई कंप्लीटली एग्री विद यू प्रियांशी, यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट. सो आई विल मॉडिफाई द स्लाइड्स आफ्टर 10 इयर्स. ओके, यू आर राइट. आई डिड नॉट, आई मीन इट्स अ वेरी simple answer, but I don't know why I did not think that way. You're right. When you're shining the X-rays on the body, sir, the body does not care whether it is. Yes, Priyanshi?
Nothing, sir.
I want to thank you, Priyanshi. Okay. Yeah.
Yes, okay.
Anybody else? Any other student would like to say something?
Sir, how to filter out K alpha radiation from the X-ray spectra, sir?
How to filter out K alpha? So there are.
Generally, I think there are monochromator we can use.
You can use monochromators, so monochromators are actually. Let me tell you, X-ray monochromators or neutron monochromators are. Even electron monochromators are single crystals itself. Okay, so they are actually single crystal because you need grating, right? Monochromators are made of grating. So for X-ray wavelengths, so basically your atom, rows of atom acts like a grating, right? Because their distances, d values are of that range. You understand? So for example, the grating. If you want to monochromate visible light, so you need actually some gratings where the spacings is in that range, and normally you have something like, you know, 6,000 lines per square inch, something like that, per inch. Okay, 8,000, 7,000, you know. So
15,000, sir.
whatever, yeah, depending upon the resolution. So that basically depending upon the lambda and yeah. So similarly, your rows of atom work like excellent rating. Got it? Yeah, for that wavelength.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Another way of filtering is basically passing them through some materials. Actually, I think that's the way X-ray filtration happens. If I'm not wrong, in X-ray machines, I think.
सर जब फिल्टर करते हैं मटेरियल के साथ में इंटरेक्ट करके तो सर मटेरियल के साथ में इंटरेक्ट उसका स्पेक्ट्रा सर हमें मिलता नहीं है.
Why do you need that? It's only for filtering, right?
But sir फिर भी क्योंकि एक्सरेस को तो पता नहीं है कि हम लोग फिल्टर कर रहे हैं. एक्सरेस तो वही कर रहे हैं.
Filters are made. Filters are designed, I guess, to take care of those problems. Okay. So that means you will not get the interference. You will not get the signal problem from the filters, right?
Yes,
filters,
sir.
Will only transmit the, it's like your glasses, you need you have these sunglasses, right?
Yes, sir.
So that's it. So you basically filter out the UVs and other waves. So that's how the filter works. Any filter will block what you don't want and it will allow what you want, nothing else. That's the role of the filter. If it is creating a problem in the signal, then that is not the filter, actually. That's not okay. Yeah. Any other question?
No, sir.
Anybody else? Dr. Bhavna, any question?
No, sir. Right now, no question.
Yeah. Deepali?
No, sir.
Yeah. Ansar, any question?
No, sir.
See, I'm going to provide you. I got your email. I'm going to provide you the recordings of the exam, and you can see the recordings, and all of you. So, because it's I recorded the sessions, so it is all transparent, and three people have given the those. Yeah, so Dr. Bhavna and Monica Malik, okay. So even if somebody has any doubt about the marks, so you can see the recordings and play everybody's answers, and then you will have the idea where you were wrong and where you need to improve. And I wish you to find out, I want you to find out, because I may not have that much of time to go through the recording again. In fact, I have an urgent manuscript now, and my student is waiting. So I have to tell my collaborator that I won't be able to work on the manuscript until tomorrow morning. So I may not have time to look at. Somehow I managed time to teach you guys. I have to steal time from here and there. So you guys can, but you can trust me that I maintain high amount of impartiality and transparency and judgmental, these things. But don't worry about that. If you are curious, then I'll share. Today I will upload the, those interviews or a quiz. So history of X-rays, again, Berkeley and Sadler, so basically laboratory X-rays are not that monochromatic, Mayur. So that's the reason that scientists, if biologists, chemists, and physicists, they all love it. Biologists also, they love it. The synchrotron. Synchrotrons are much, 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 much better when it comes to the X-rays. They are much monochromatic, and but they were observed as it is written half a century later, and by the time the applications of X-rays was very much established. So this is the short history that you can see how many Nobel prizes were given, and Berkeley and Sadler discovered the this characteristic X-ray radiation, and then Frederick von Loewe, this idea actually came from Frederick and Nipping. actually. It was, and then Van Leeuwen implemented that, and then he got the Nobel Prize, and then, you know, the Bragg story, father and son Bragg. And unfortunately, this incident was Mosley, actually. You know, the Mosley's, this periodic table, what we see is not Mendeleev's periodic table. It's not, it's Mosley's periodic table. I hope you all know about it, some of you.
Sir.
Yes, sir. Apne bataya tha.
Ha?
Apne bataya.
Yes, sir.
Kisko pata hai? Priyanshi, tumhe pata hai?
Sir, before the discovery of the Mosley, the periodic table were arranged by the means of the atomic weight. Then after the discovery of the Mosley, they have arranged the
I want to ask
atomic
chemist will only answer. Priyanshi, bolo.
Yes, sir. Mosley ne sir atomic number ke basis pe matlab rakha tha, because
somehow Mendeleev is glorified more than Mosley, actually. I feel that Mosley's contribution was much higher than Mendeleev's contribution.
Sir, Mosley ne wo graph ke form mein rakha tha aur Mendeleev ne table ke form mein rakha tha.
Yeah, I'll tell you the story. It's not like that. You know, as somebody else has, Mayur has mentioned that this periodic table, Mendeleev's periodic table was messed up. I'll show you the history. I have actually one slide I have added actually today. So then came actually satellite emissions and so and so forth. And then another another incident I would like to highlight. It's just history today. Meitner was Lisa Meitner was a woman scientist. Actually, she discovered Auger electron. Auger was not the first person to discover what we call, like, you know, Auger electron. He put his name, but Lisa Meitner independently discovered. So it should have been Meissner effect, Meitner effect. Lisa Meitner electron, not the Auger electron. So there are two side story I have today to carry. One is about Mosley. Mosley did not get his due credit, and he was one of the brightest physicists. He actually died the same year, actually. I'll tell you the story. So that year, 1914, no Nobel Prize was awarded. 1916, no Nobel Prize was given, actually. So this is the picture of synchrotron radiation. Yes?
Now, what is two electron excitation, sir?
Moment. Yeah, basically, it is related to, you know, like you have this two photon excitation, right? You have two photon spectroscopy. Okay, so basically two electrons can excite the, you know, two incoming electrons can excite, you know, then they can transfer the energy probably, and then two events, independent events. And then you have basically, you can excite the electron to higher orbit, and then you have probably much, you know, different. I mean, you can have different. You know, I'm not sure. I have to check that. I might have forgotten. I mean, I must know it actually. Wenzel, actually, we have read. Actually, I have read. I remember reading it, but right now I don't remember. You can maybe probably you can check for me also. So. But I'm it slipping out of my mind right now, because I have not brought this since long while, actually. It should be in my notes, because I make sure that I read what I'm writing, actually. But probably I'm carried away by more famous events than Wenzel's observation. So, okay, yeah. Any other question? So let us go in sequence. So I'm more excited to tell you about Mosley and Lisa Meitner. So let us discuss some science in addition to the history. Then we'll come to the history later on. So what happens when electron knocks out? And I can skip it, because all of you are aware of this. So I can skip it. Okay. Auger electroscopy, I think all of you know about it. So Auger effect was discovered independently by Lisa Meitner and Pierre Auger in 1920s. So the discovery was made by Meitner and initially reported. She has already published her work in 1922, but it is very sad that her contribution, which was published contribution, was not recognized actually. So this is the, I show the photograph of this. There was a lot of injustice to women scientists back then. So many of the women scientists were not recognized. So she's one of them. So she was that was a problem. And she was also the part of the team which discovered nuclear fission. And for that, she did not get the Nobel Prize, but her colleague Otto Hahn got Nobel Prize. That is another sad part. You can see her working in the lab. Okay. It's a photograph, and you can see this lady working. Boltzmann was her PhD advisor, apart from Max Planck. Actually, you can see the those names. Okay, and she influenced actually Otto Hahn, and Otto Hahn got the Nobel Prize. Okay, so that's what I have taken from Wikipedia. So anyway, so Meitner. Meitner is often mentioned as one of the most glaring example of women's scientific achievement overlooked by the Nobel Committee. Please note that. It's a bold statement. It took so many years, okay, so many years. 1920 she discovered, 1922, and then 75 years, then Physics Today, which is very popular magazine, in Physics Committee. It concluded that Meitner's omission was a rare instance where personal negative opinion ki Priyanshi achhi ladki nahi hai aur maan lo Priyanshi ne kuch discover kar diya hai to negative opinion ban gayi Priyanshi ko Nobel Prize nahi milega ye problem hai ali Priyanshi fact nahi mana jayega kyun Priyanshi dhyan rakhna aisa hota hai ha
yes sir ha
तो पर्सनल नेगेटिव ओपिनियन भारी हो जाती है कई बार हम लोग पर्सनल लेवल पे ले जाते हैं है ना एंड बिकॉज ऑफ दैट अ डिजर्विंग साइंटिस्ट मिस द नोबेल प्राइज एंड लुक एट योर व्हेनेवर यू लुक एट द पीरियोडिक टेबल यू शुड पे ग्रेटिट्यूड टू द एलिमेंट यू नो एटलीस्ट एलिमेंट नंबर 109 व्हिच इज एक्चुअली नेम्ड इन हर ऑनर सो When you celebrate Women's Day, I hope one of the women, say this as an example. He is the guy. Actually, I started hating him actually after I heard that story. Actually, I don't like his face. I will not show it now. I somehow started, not liking his because he should have told the scientific community that this is not me, this is her. I'm sure that he was aware of her work actually. Why this guy did not tell that this is not me, this is her contribution. You understand what I mean? The problem is from the person who got the Nobel Prize also. Why he did not speak up that mera nahi hai contribution, ye uska hai. So I think you all know about this ionization process. So I'll skip it. Person who named, have you ever wondered that the KLM, who was a guy who named this random, KLM is an airlines. I have flew through, it's basically Royal Dutch Airlines, KLM, I have flown through KLM so many times in my life. And and we know the energy levels, KLM, this, okay. So why would somebody name it as KLM? Kabhi socha tum logo ne? उसके लिए कुछ कोई आंसर नहीं है इट वाज बेसिकली चार्ल्स बर्कला ही वाज अ ब्रिटिश फिजिसिस्ट एक्चुअली ही नेम्ड फर्स्ट द फर्स्ट चोज के एज फर्स्ट शेल शायद उसके बच्चे का नाम के से स्टार्ट होता होगा आई डोंट नो या फिर उसकी पत्नी का नाम के से स्टार्ट होता होगा आई एम नॉट श्योर और उसको पता भी नहीं था कि ही विल नीड सूट एल शेल एंड जे शेल और समथिंग आई मीन ही डिड नॉट नो सो देन we have this KLM actually, right? So that's another very interesting story I'm sharing with you apart from science, history, from history, the closets of the history. So he got Nobel Prize and he made significant contributions in developing understanding of X-rays. Very great, I mean, great scientist actually. And I love his mustache actually. I want to have something like this. Okay. So his advisor was none other than J.J. Thompson. You can see his name. I don't know Oliver Lodge. I mean, it's not a very famous name, but so you can read all this thing. I don't want to. This is all standard thing which you have. You can find in any nomenclature of the shell. You all know about it. But this is very interesting that I mean, many times we forget that many times students ask that on why copper, why not cobalt or another source. So here you have other options. Cobalt wavelength is also not very far, 1.788. And molybdenum is also 0.7. It's also used as a source. Yeah, it is a very important statement. Please remember that it is related to the questions which several of you asked me. That the problem is that the detector we use does not discriminate that much from the subshell. I mean, it won't be able to identify from, for example, K alpha or K beta. Forget about alpha 1, beta 1. So energy the resolution is not that good. So that's why be very careful. I always tell that energy resolution of EDEX is not that great. Be very careful when you look at the atomic numbers, actually, right? Yeah. So how do we relate the X-ray energy to the atomic number? Here comes the Moseley. Moseley actually gave this great, that's how we started knowing the another. So X-ray crystallography was developed already, you know, by Brax and von Loewe. But then Moseley immediately after a few years developed the X-ray spectroscopy. So X-ray crystallography and together with X-ray spectroscopy, both the pillars, you know, so two pillars are important, X-ray crystallography and X-ray spectroscopy. You can see that. So X-ray spectroscopy credit goes to none other than Moseley. And yeah, now you see the periodic table, which was given by Mendeleev. You can see how messy it is. You know, it was organized by as atomic weight rather than atomic number. And you can see there is a big mess. You can see now it's much clearer. So these elements were known at the Mendeleev time. You can see how he has arranged. But and then came Moseley and his Moseley plot, and then overnight this mess was which existed. This simple physics discovery cleared the mess which existed in the periodic table. But somehow I'm at NCL. When there was a periodic table, you know that you're celebrating International Year of Periodic Table. Chemists, they don't somehow acknowledge the contribution of Moseley, but they contribute the contribution, Mendeley more than Moseley. I don't know. I would equally contribute, equally honor both of them. So anyway, so this is actually his original plot. This is a book, nice book for physics students, CF Foot Atomic Physics. It's a nice book actually. So this I've taken from that book. And this is the photograph actually. And he was a student of Rutherford, and Rutherford actually, he described that he's one of the most talented student, and actually he died in World War One. The same year actually World War One broke out, and where this Queen, British Empire, they jumped in, and then he was sent to the Turkey, and then there was a big war at Gallipoli, and he was a radio engineer actually. He was not actually fighting with guns. He was a support actually, and then but he was a telecommunication officer, and physicists they used to get immediately job in BSNL actually. I remember when I was doing MSc in physics, everybody knew that I will get. That time, when if you do MSc physics, you will get job at BSNL actually, telecommunication officer, easily actually. So yeah, but I did not want I took plasma physics because I did not want a BSNL job. I was very clear about that because that time engineering was not that anyway. So Mosley was shot and killed, and he was just 27. And in that same war, 5,000 Indian soldiers, our own brothers, our own people, brothers of our ancestors, whatever, they were killed. Maybe probably more than 5,000. 5,000 is just for no reason. See, they were fighting somebody else's war actually. So in 1916, Nobel Prize went unawarded, and it is Asimov. I think all of you know Isaac Asimov. He mentioned that if he had not died, he would have got the Nobel Prize. So with this, I would like to stop my lecture. So today, probably maybe some other time, I'll start. This new topic, which is very interesting actually, and I would like to spend some more time here on Monday. Okay, and we can discuss, we can take a lot of questions today if you have any.